First of all, I'd like to thank to Juan, organizing committee and Ebu Zer for inviting me here. And it's really great honor for me to speak, to see you after a while in front of masters, Rotom fellows and friends. It's really great honor for me. Now, I want to talk about surgical approaches to diffuse pontine gliomas. Diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma, from now on I will call it a DIPG, has dismal prognosis, poor prognosis, and overall median survival is 9 to 11 months. Brainstem tumors are prevalent, especially in pediatric population, and it accounts 13% of all primary CNS tumors in child age group. And it has a peak incidence between 5 and 10 years and without gender bias. The clinical presentation has classical triad of long trunk signs with motor weakness, cranial neuropathies, and cerebellar signs. The diagnosis is with history, neurological examination, and with brain imaging. And it has a typical characteristics of MRI findings. I will show you in representative cases and we'll talk in details. And for now, the IPG is unresectable because of its location and because of infiltrative nature to the surrounding structures. And unfortunately, WHO grade did not influence the survival. And in the most recent WHO classification, it's classified as midline gliomas, WHO grade 4, and regardless of the histology. First of all, for the treatment, it's the radiation therapy, but it adds only 3 to 4 months to survival, and then followed by chemotherapy. Unfortunately, clinical or radiographic tumor progression seen 3 to 8 months after completion of therapy.
Asking, excuse me to interrupt you again. Can you go to present? You are still, we're seeing the window, but we're still seeing your desktop on the background. See okay. If you can maximize your slide.
Hold on.
There you go. Okay. Yep. Okay. No, yes. Thank you.
Okay.
Good. Very good.
In recent decades, the survival has not improved despite several treatment strategies that have been explored. And in, this is the picture from PubMed. It shows the DIPG researchers. And in the last 2 decades, researchers focused on to find the chemotherapy or any treatment method for DIPG, and we see the how people focused, especially in last 2 decades. In the 80s, it was said the biopsy was unnecessary, but in the last decade, for the standard of care, the tissue is necessary for clinical trials, especially for genetic and molecular studies. So the stereotactic biopsy is done before the treatment. Although the complication is rate is very low with the stereotactic biopsy, we see in some reports dissemination through the needle trajectory of the tumor. Total resection for focal, superficial, and exophytic lesions is possible, but for intrinsic brainstem gliomas, it's not possible. So DTI, in previous lectures, we had a good presentations. Before the operation, functional tracts and the tumor and where can be visualized, and we can choose a trajectory to the target area by the help of DTI imaging. What's the goal of the surgery? The goal of the surgery is partially debulk the tumor to confirm the diagnosis and improve the symptoms of the patient. Here is the representative case. A 4-year-old boy diagnosed the IPG 1 year ago, and he had a radiation therapy and chemotherapy. And he presented to us, when he came to us, he was drowsy, sleepy in her mom's head, confined to bed, left hemiplegic, facial palsy, difficult of swallowing, and the oncologist sent him to home, saying terminal stage. We get the MRI, and in T2 weighted images, we see an infiltrative pontine glioma, and in contrast-enhanced tumor images, we see the peripheral contrast enhancement and necrosis in the center of the tumor. With DTI, I prefer raw data because reconstruction of the DTI tracks is not easy as in normal cases in this infiltrative tumor. So we can see all the structures with the raw data, and we can, so we saw that the tumor pushed normal structures to the periphery and make a corridor to remove and debulk the tumor. So we thought that we can help the patient by surgery. We got these MRI images without giving any sedation or any anesthesia to the patient. He was just lying still. So we put the MRI machine and we got these images and without any sedation. So think about the patient situation before the operation. So after checking the MRIs, we decided to go to lateral infratrigeminal lateral window. So we have seen very good anatomical dissections, but just to go overview, this is the trigeminal nerve, middle cerebral peduncular fibers, crossing over the pontine midline. And on lateral view, we see medial lemniscus, cortical spinal tract, medial lemniscus, ventral pons, and dorsal pons. And we see the cortical spinal tract. These are from Rotten collections, these dissections. This is the anterior view, cortical spinal tract, cortical bulbar tract, and we see the cortical pontine tract. On the lateral view, we see trigeminal nerve, 7 and 8 here. So our entry point is here, subtrigeminal, infratrigeminal corridor. So by this trajectory, we can reach all of these area. This is the retrosigmoid approach. Cerebellum was retracted. We see trigeminal nerve, 7 and 8, 7th nerve, 9, 10, 11. And this is the area interest that we will go in. And this is the incision, again, trigeminal nerve, and 7 and 8. We see closer view and 6th nerve. Now the operative video I want to show you. This is the lower cranial nerves, 9, 10, 11. We dissect the arachnoid, and this is the trigeminal nerve. Now we are dissecting the 7 and 8, and we are checking with intraoperative monitorization, see the pons and occupy the peduncular cisterns, interpeduncular and pontine cistern. Now we are doing incision infratrigeminal area, and yes, we saw the tumor here. It is the grayish tumor. Now we are getting biopsy, for pathology and for the genetic and molecular research, then by using ultrasonic aspirator, we are removing the tumor, see the normal tissue color and the normal tissue color and the tumor color is, so we can differentiate macroscopically. As we resect the tumor, it comes to our view, see, not much retraction. So we resect it and it comes to our view. Again, we are debulking the tumor. So the pores getting smaller in size. And we see the cisterns. This is trigeminal nerve again. So it's really very difficult then after removing the necrotic.
Oradan acil olarak bir MR çekildi. Doktorlar hemen anlamışlar ciddi bir şey olduğunu.
3 months after the operation. And this is the post-operative video. I try to put same slices, see, after resection, the bones come to normal, not exactly normal, but close to normal shape, and the normal neural tissue debulked, and the patient improved the symptoms, and he had a chance for re-irradiation or for clinical trials for chemotherapy agents. And the surgery added his quality of life, I think. And this is the T2 images. Again, see the preoperative and postoperative videos. So the second case, this is the last case. I don't want to show all of them, but just I have chosen two cases to show you. Again, same history. A 4-year-old boy diagnosed the IPG 1 year ago. He had a radiation therapy and chemotherapy, presented almost same precomatous, quadriparetic, facial palsy, difficulty of swallowing. And here is the preoperative MRI. Again, very huge tumor with contrasting periphery of the tumor and necrosis in the center. We operated, decided to operate from posterior approach through the fourth ventricle. Here is the schematic representation that we can reach is approach. It's also mentioned in Maximiliano's presentation, very nice. I won't go in deep details, but we have to know very vital structures, facial colliculus, vagal and hypoglossal triangles. And the safe entry zones, either supra or infra facial colliculus. It was mentioned in detail. And here is the post-operative video of the patient. And again, the symptoms of the patient improved. He survived 10 months after his last situation. So I think with this surgery, we added 10 months for the survival. And for these tumors, first of all, radiation therapy and chemotherapy, then surgery. Normally for the brain tumors, we operate and send patient to oncology, but here is the reverse. First radiation therapy, chemotherapy, then if we need, we can do surgery. So, my aim is not resect all the intrinsic brain tumors, pontine gliomas. The take-home message here is BIPG is unresectable. Okay, I accept. But large tumors may push vital structures, causing space to operate these tumors. Perioperative MRI, especially DTI, helpful for deciding, and surgery may help to patients in selected cases. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Askin. That was very impressive. Great going into those, let's say, inoperable tumors. Excellent job. We have one question, team, from the audience that they're asking if you have experienced bony artifacts during DTI study. For example, can you follow the optic nerve into the optic canal, or inside the bone, can you follow fiber tracks or nerves in this case?
Yes, we have very problem with bony artifact. Maybe Jack has much more experience with that, but we really have big problems with bone and closer to bony structures.
Tim, you want to comment too?
Yeah, sure. That's a crucial point. The thing is, when you want to do fiber tracking on anything on the skull base, you need to do a very careful correction of distortion artifacts. That's a very important